This is Sonali. Thank you all for carving out some time for attending episode 5 of BX Academy, Business Excellence, Mentoring and Coaching. Today's episode is on data intelligence for business excellence. To all the attendees out there, please type in any questions you might have in the Q&A section and we'll try to answer as many as possible at the end of the session. I would now like to welcome our speaker, Mr. Gaurav Marya, Chairman and Founder of the Franchise India Group. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you, Sonali. And welcome, friends, and welcome to another edition with the Business X Academy. This is an initiative by Business X, which is a part of Franchise India Group, where every week on Saturday, we talk about a particular subject of part of our Business Excellence series. And we talk about how you can implement those strategies in your businesses to grow your business or improve your business. Our endeavor at Franchise India and Business X is to help especially small businesses and startups to go to the next level. Business X actually is an organization set up for three things. One, obviously, we help companies to raise capital. Second, we work with them on developing their growth strategy. And third, in some cases, we will also do their exit planning if they're looking to exit the business. So we'll make it very interactive. So it's about 30 minutes of a series, which I would discuss on today, data analysis, data intelligence. I like to have many questions from you. So use the Q&A box to ask any questions at the last 5 or 7 minutes. I'll try to take as many questions you need to. So today's topic is actually about data intelligence. And that's very, very important aspect now for all businesses. And especially if you look at small and early stage businesses, they don't have any department called data analysis. This would really run into the founders themselves or owners themselves, and they would have to really work on that. And it's not on the priority list for them. So which means that they would continue to collect a lot of data, which is part of anywhere our organizational cycles now, because we are in a digital world. So almost everything has a lot of touch points and a lot of touch points that get recorded. But we don't really have any conscious effort done towards understanding the intelligence out of it. And I know organizations, even the largest organizations, are not putting that focus. Even look at what has happened in the current COVID period, right? We had a full cycle of 1 year for a COVID, which was running in India. And nobody, even the government of India, didn't put any kind of analytics to understand the second wave and how big it can be and so on and so forth. Now they're doing it. Now everybody's understood the importance of data. So almost all educational institutes of India are putting a lot of data. A lot of research organizations are putting a lot of data. So a lot of that is going on now. So we are bringing in predictability of the third wave and the fourth wave, the preparations would required and so on and so forth. But other countries, if you look at Singapore and other countries, really have done this in the first wave itself. They started working on a lot of data points to really understand what is going to be the impact of what is coming up ahead of us. And if you cannot do this currently in your businesses, it becomes even more difficult to sustain your businesses for future. So I would strongly insist that really put some kind of a conscious focus on understanding your data, understanding what the business is telling you, what is your organization telling you, and so on and so forth. And so you're able to make your organization much more smarter to handle the issues and future challenges which it can really bring in. So what are we going to cover today? I'll cover 5 different topics. One, we will understand the need of data intelligence, why we need that today more than ever. Second, we'll understand the decision-making process, how decisions should be done in organization or how they are done and how this can really impact your decisions. Third, what is your data cycle, how the data should be collected. And then we'll understand the larger business intelligence, because end of the day, there is so much of data which is available now, but not everything is on use to me. And you have to really bring in objectivity. What do you need to really hear from that data? What do you want from that answer from that? I think that's very, very important. Otherwise, these are too much on these days, and this whole data space has become very, very big. And it's becoming even more confusing. And you need to be very, very objective in terms of what you want from, what kind of business intelligence you want from the data. And 5 steps, last point would be the 5 steps how to implement that. So let's get started. Understand the need first. You know, what is the need of having data intelligence in place? Every organization needs to take an effective and timely decision. That's very, very important now. And if you're not effective or you're not on time, you will live either miss the opportunity or you will lose the customer. So it's very important at this stage, the organizations for really to understand and forecast demand. Like, for example, current times, if you look at this, very, very challenging. How do you really forecast demand? And especially for manufacturing organizations, I'm seeing this a lot of big problems going on because they don't not able to predict their demand cycles, which is happening. A lot of look at the auto companies. They were slow. They stopped their production. And then this thing started reviving. They had a good Q3 and Q3 was good. And Q4, Q5 was looking very good. And they start ramping up the production. And again, we come down to this situation. So a lot of companies are into this huge issue of how they can really bring in what I call demand forecast. What kind of demand we would see in times to come and how the data can tell us that this is going to happen. And this is very, very important. Second, which is always a trigger point where companies start looking at going into their data intelligence is when they see the consumer churn or a consumer attrition. Like most of the telecom companies, when they started getting from another thing, earlier there was no policy of you can shift from one organization to another brand. And as this guideline came in and people started seeing moving from the entire thing and companies got into action and they started putting a lot of understanding, sampling the customer, going out and reaching to the customer and say, why are you shifting and things like that. And that's very difficult at that time because your churn cycle has already begun. And even if you go out and sample 1,000 people, it not tell you what is happening largely in your subscriber base because your subscriber base of millions and millions. And what kind of size can tell you why the people are so much shifting outside. And that is actually not the best time you really should start your data understanding, data intelligence, because you should do much before. Because when the churn cycle really starts, it's very difficult at that time. But most of the companies would really do it at a stage when they have a larger attrition happening of their customer. They are losing customer faster than they know. And that is the time they would start putting up the data. Another area which is becoming more and more important is to understand what other value-added products or services you will be able to give to the same customer. And customer is telling you a lot of things, but we are not capturing. We're just trying to deliver, but not hearing them out. And these days, if you look at what is going around us, almost everything is delivered to our home. And most of the time, they come and just deliver. But they don't really capture anything, what you were looking at, what else you were looking at, and things like that. There is a company which was actually formed by Reliance called Rescue. You know, it came from the need of the customer base. So Reliance Digital used to be the large umbrella brand and they used to be in consumer electronics and they used to go out and put appliances in people's home. Later they found that the inefficiencies because they used to sell the appliance, I'd say they sell a Samsung TV and a Samsung guy would come from there and go and fit the TV. Because this lag was big time because I made a decision to buy from Reliance Digital today and Samsung came after 3 days. So customer was not happy. So Reliance started taking that responsibility also additionally that they would go out and fulfill this requirement and actually do the fulfillment on the behalf of Samsung, which obviously brought the better efficiencies. They were able to deliver much, much faster. And then they really went to homes and they actually started fitting it for the customer. The customer started asking about other appliances they have in the house. And average home have many different brands and different service points. You know, you have small appliances, big appliances, you have other gadgets, and you need a different service provider for that. And that's where Reliance really saw an opportunity that average home would have maybe 50 different brands and it is impossible for them to really go out and take service from different OEMs. If there can be a company which can come from a value addition of Reliance Digital called Rescue, which can go and address that need. And that's how this was multi-brand service outfit, which was created. So it really came from what customer was telling you. So sometimes a lot of value-added products or services really can come in. Also, it is very useful when you're scaling up. Data intelligence is very important before you scale, because sale is a very, very important and very crucial decision in companies. When they really want to ramp up and go up, they need to really put that emphasis. You need to really engage a strong research team which can work with you at that stage before, unless and until you're absolutely convinced on why you want to do that. I'll give you an example. I'm consulting a company which is actually a 100-year-plus tea gardening company. So they were one of the finest exporters of teas to the world. And they found a particular gap that they had a product which they just launched is called the black tea product. And they felt that Indians don't drink black tea because they feel that it's very bitter. The normal tea which you get, which is a CTC tea you get, is very bitter. And they launched a product which can be had without having a milk. Now, this is a very clearly an opportunity case they have found. But it needed a lot of other research points. Why would people shift? What is the compelling reason why they would shift from the conventional tea, which is now actually a habit to everybody? People have grown up on that. They don't even know that there is a other option which is available. What is the compelling reason why they shift? Well, we saw in very clearly in green tea, when green tea was launched, it was not the best taste. People liked it, but it was purely a health quotient, which triggered people to shift from there. So all these are very important when you really want to really scale or get into the next level. You need to really go back and see the kind of preferences customer is telling you. Another thing which is very important, and when people look at using data intelligence, is then when they are looking for a large part of their growth cycle. And growth comes from three things, you know, only three things which I would understand in my consulting experience. If you want to really grow your enterprise, only three areas you need to focus. One is new product, new channel, and new markets. These are three things which are very important. So how do you really use your data intelligence to define new products which you have? What is a new channel you can use? You're delivering customer to through this channel. Can you go it from this channel also? Is your data telling you? You can add to certain more convenience to the customer. Like a lot of things are now becoming direct to home, direct to consumer businesses. And third is, what are the new markets which you have not explored? You can do that. So this is what the need part of it. And you also have to define, you know, there are three cycles to me in the whole data intelligence. One is the data itself, where it is coming from. Second is the information it is giving you. And third, what can be knowledge draw you can do out of that? What kind of knowledge you can really get out of that information, which is important. Actually, you process the knowledge. The data and information are just about really cyclic in order in terms of doing it. Now, a lot of companies have really created many ideas out of that. I'll give you example. There is a company I was advising, and I met the founder of Swiggy. Swiggy is a very household name for home deliveries, and they really started a dark kitchen, FMCG business in Gurgaon, and started testing it. Why? Because then they were doing deliveries in Gurgaon, and these were late night deliveries. People started asking a lot of FMCG products for them. A lot of young people and a lot of other people asking for cigarettes and other things in the late night. And there's nothing which is available at that time. So they realized that an odd hour, especially in the late year, when the supermarkets and your grocery stores or convenience stores are shut, at that time, people also needed a lot of FMCG to be delivered. And they had the platform because they were anyway doing late night deliveries for food. And they started thinking that, can we do this piece also? Now, they started that pilot. Pilot was not so successful. They didn't go forward on that because the sample size or the ask was not big enough, which means that there was a demand, but demand was so small that it cannot be implemented across board. I remember that when they first saw this as an opportunity, they thought that they would probably go and put up these 2,000 dark FMCG stores, where they would do the fulfillment of basic staples and basic things. And then later they dropped the idea because it was not sizable. It might be an indicative of one particular market telling you some indications, but it cannot be generalized overall as an opportunity. And then say they dropped it. So they did a pilot. They opened up a couple of stores of that nature, but they didn't scale it up after seeing this early results were not very encouraging for them to do that. Now let's get into the second part of my discussion, is what is the decision-making process? At what levels different decisions are taken on the data? What data tells you and how you do that? First is very operational decisions, which are normally done at the point of sales cycle, right? Which is the almost front-ending teams would take that decision, which means discounting. It can be many other things which really comes from your data, what customer is looking at. And also maybe comparing with your competition, you took this operational decision. These are normally short-term decisions taken by very, very operational hands-on teams. While obviously it will come strategic from the top management, but it's normally those decisions taken. Second are more tactical decisions, which are designed for your promotion cycles. You have 3-month cycle or a 6-month cycles, what you want to do, or a new product launch cycles. These are very clearly decisions on that. And then the third decision, which are more strategic, which are long-term decisions, are normally done when you have even a complete innovation of a product to be done, or an absolute change of strategy, or you want to shift from a, you know, offline to an online space, or vice versa, and things of that. These are decisions which should be very, very compelling and come from a very long-term viewpoint on that. Now let's get into the third part, which to me is a data cycle. You know, what is a data cycle and how you really get this data? Historically, there are two ways which we would really read the data. One is through expert viewpoint. Expert viewpoint means that you have every single thing which happens in your organization. There is a process lead. So your sales head would tell you what is happening in sales and what he's hearing from a market and things of that. So, or you can have even an expert from outside, a consulting firm or a research firm, and they would give you some kind of a opinion on, which is very expert opinion. Somebody who belongs to that domain would give you that opinion. Second is actually what is your organizational knowledge base, which means that at every point of your organization, it can be different departments, you capturing a lot of sense, and you combine all that which through a data mining and get that expertise. So one is a very data-centric capability, and second is very expert viewpoint on that. And both has advantages and disadvantages. When you are working purely on data, then that's advantage is that you're not really depending on somebody's viewpoint. You are actually reading the data. A lot of times, actually, business owners take decision on the expert side. They don't really read the data. And data might be telling you something else. And the expert has his own viewpoint to tell you what he feels would be there. But if you look at only data and you don't look at expert, the data can be purely historical. It cannot predict sometimes the future. It is very historical in nature. So you need to really understand that it might give you what has been done in the business so far, but it will not tell you what is there. But with expert, you obviously can also find out what is going to be the future, because they can have some kind of trends which they can really capture. So I would always try to mix these two. You know, I will try to mix these two options. Hear the experts, what they're telling. Park it there. Don't make opinions on that. And also hear from the data what it's telling, and then try to make a combination of that. And that would give you a little bit of what I call business intelligence, which is my next point. How do you really build a business intelligence from there? What do you want to know from this data? And what is the information you are seeking? The first information to me would be your product preferences, how the consumer is making the product or a service preferences with you. It can be price, it can be overall product relevance. And these are very important points. You know, every boardroom has a brilliant idea that, oh, let's reduce the price by this, and there would be a larger audience to take that. Sometimes it is not true. In my company, in a service business, we were offering one of our services at X price, and I asked my senior team and say, what should we do? And they said, let's drop the price because of this, whatever COVID is going on, let's drop the price and we'll get customers. And I asked them, is this only a decision for people not to take it because they cannot have affordability issue, or we have only overall shrunk the market? Is the market itself is shrunk, and because it shrunk, we are giving the reason that we should grow the price down, but actually it might be lesser customer which are willing to pay the same or more price for what needs to be done. So you have to be really intelligent why you want to take that decision. Sometimes the overall market has shrunk, but the demand of your loyal customers or people have that thing, they are paying, they are actually happy to pay you more because they want to really get that service done. So it will not be like for restaurants when they opened partially in the COVID period, almost every restaurant was trying to sell cheap to encourage people to do that. Actually, it was wrong strategy. And I actually did a webinar and educated people that this is a wrong strategy, because anybody who's stepping out in the risk to come into your restaurant and eat is willing to pay you the best price. And he also appreciates that you are also underperforming and would not mind that you are, while you cannot overcharge, but you can charge the right price. There is no way you should at that stage discount and create an excitement for people to just come out and risk to have a cheaper burger or something like that. So one has to really see how do you really, what are you trying to understand from what your data is telling. Second is your customer acquisition lifecycle, how your customer is acquired and how the fulfillment is done. So all that piece needs to be understood, how you can build better efficiencies. consumer demographics. Like, for example, I was talking to one of our clients, is actually based out of Middle East, and they have operations in South India. It's a children fashion company, and they have stores only in certain part of South India, which is largely Kerala. They have stores, and their online is telling a very different strategy. Is telling that the maximum demand is coming from markets like East and up north and so on and so forth. So when I asked the chairman of the company and said, look, what is your strategy for growth? From an operational viewpoint, he was very comfortable in doing South India, but the indications of what people are making preferences on, especially for online, is coming from other markets, not coming so much from the market he was operational. Now, so this is can be a different strategy. You might have an online, a different strategy, and for your offline business, a different strategy, because they both are different operational design sets. And you can probably go and market yourself more online in the eastern and the northern markets, where you're getting more demand and better conversion cycles are happening. Your conversion ratios are better. And maybe continue to have your retail brick and mortar strategy more concentrated on the south. Then a lot of things other than that we should really ask from data is, how do we build better supply chain efficiencies? How do we save cost and time? How do you boost productivity? Productivity is very, very important, and especially businesses which are non-technology. Defining productivity is a big challenge. What do you really expect from your workforce? What kind of productivity they can do? And especially in these times where a lot of them are working from home and things of that nature, productivity becomes a very important aspect. Also, understanding different needs a consumer would have, and it might be shifting. And significantly, you might not know, because you don't have any kind of sales dip. You feel that your sales is still growing and robust. That doesn't mean that consumer is continuing to enjoy the same kind of offering which you have. It might already have shifted, but because there was no alternative available, they are sticking with you. So one has to be very conscious. A lot of times we see sales numbers as an indicative to the consumer preferences. Answer is no. Customer might have shifted already, but he's not really seen moving out of your sales function, because there is no alternative at this being presented. So as the alternative would be presented, there will be complete shift off. So that's what has happened to a lot of businesses which suddenly go out of business because they didn't understand that the customer was already not there. It was waiting for an alternative to be driven. And how do you really also build a transparency and a relationship, a deeper relationship with your customer base? How do you bring predictability to read the future? As I said, how do you are ready for future collaborations? Product might need something else tomorrow, which you currently don't have capability. You might have to collaborate with somebody else. So all these things help you to make much better and faster decision-making in the business. Now let's go to the last part of my today's presentation. How do you put the five steps of putting data intelligence into your business? First step is integrate your data. Understand the source, understand the size you have got, the sample size you've got, and what kind of substance you get. We call that triple S. Source, size, and substance. How do you get, what kind of insights you are getting out of that? What is the kind of innovation is expected in whatever you want to change, and can be small innovation which you want to really implement, and how would you integrate within your organization? That's very, very important aspect. This is before even you have started making any kind of action. This is just about integrating your data and understanding your data well. Then this data gets into the actionable intelligence. How do we really put this into action? I call the four fits, which are very important for any decision of your business which you want to take. Put these four fits into place. All four fits are very important to run through. Strategic fit, financial fit, operational fit, and marketing fit. You want to make this action because you read this piece. Is it going to be financially viable for you to take that? Is it a right call at this moment for you to make that additional investment to maybe produce a new product or change the strategy or change your channel? Whatever you want to do, which data is telling you, is it a right financial decision? Is it a right operational decision? Because it might burden your current operational structure. Operationally, you cannot manage that decision which you want to really bring in. Is it something which can come from the same marketing bandwidth or approach you have, or the consumer would see from the same perspective coming from you? And is it strategic for the organization to take that call? Sometimes the strategic call is so big that you have to take some major financial calls also, because it is very strategic for you to do that. So first is understand data integration. Second is how do you build what I call actionable intelligence? And then third goes into a little bit of a competitive intelligence. You need to also understand your competition, and competition today is direct and indirect competition. How do you really build your competitive intelligence on that? How do you understand from the mistakes of your competition, what they have done you don't want to do? How do you create a differentiator than your competition? Or understanding your core value system, what you need to do. And sometimes your competition is large enough, you know, and there is no way you can compete on all points. Then you need to really find your core competence and say, I would do this best and stick to that part of entire thing and leave aside everything. I like the company called ISB. ISB was a consumer electronic company, still very strong as an organization. And they also had temptation, like a lot of other companies like BPL and Videocon and other companies, to become a full-blown appliance company and get into all appliances. And most of these companies, Onida and everybody else, was actually trying to get into almost everything. And if now you look at it, almost everybody is out of business. They all are out of business, and IFB is still strong because they were very clearly driven from their core competence, and they were very, very strong on that. Similarly, Voltas were very strong on their core competence, and they still as a strong company on that. And a lot of other companies which came in this space got lost, and they lost their competence. They were actually doing everything, but they didn't have a leadership in any of the pieces which is there. So understand your competition. The fourth point is understand real-time visibility and insights. Don't lose. Even if you have that, continue to check what the signals are coming in. I call the test and measure. Anytime you really implement any decision which comes from your data understanding or your business intelligence, if you put that decision, go and test and measure. Because if you test and measure, you will be able to manage things better. You cannot manage what you cannot measure. That's very, very important. And that would be your very important aspect. And the fifth point is, once you have made some kind of a strong decision or any kind of innovation which is implemented, do an incremental improvement continuously. Keep reading the data. What is it telling you? If it's giving good signs, keep doing your incremental improvement. Incremental improvement would put the whole flow chart in a structure that you will continue to grow as an organization and improve your efficiencies and your delivery to customers. So data and business analytics is the real muscle of delivering what I call operational and business excellence. So this was a topic for today. I hope that these points which you got, I have covered about five different points, which is the overall need, decision-making process, overall data cycle, business intelligence, what you want from the data, and fifth is how do you really implement this. So over to you, Sonali, for any questions if you have. I will be happy to take that.
Thank you so much, Gaurav sir, for another wonderful and insightful session for all our attendees. We do have quite a few questions lined up with us, and I would like to take up the first one. So the first question is, what kind of data points should I be looking at for leveraging my data? I come from a retail business background.
You know, so if you are in retail tells you a lot of data points. Again, go back to the same thing, data, information, and knowledge. Data points would be what is selling, how much, which SKU is selling, what needs to be done. The information you will draw on that is what is customer basket looks like, how much they are paying to buy, what is the average buying cycle, who's buying, what age group they are coming. You know, so the whole average basket size, average price side, how it is improving, growing, not growing. All these are what I call this. And knowledge you would draw on that is more important to me, you know, which would be really about understanding, what was the conversion ratio which you were getting, how you can improve that conversion ratio, which means that footfall to conversion, what is happening, then average conversion to improving or ticket value, what ticket value is a benchmark from a market. Say the other competition is doing 600 rupees and you're doing 400, but why are you not doing that? It's because you don't have required SKU or the offering or the any kind of a structure. So all these are this business, this would create a knowledge base. This would create what I call actionable intelligence. Information you would draw from the data. And data is just about, you know, what has sold in the place and when it was sold, who made a purchase decision to buy what they want to buy that app.
Right. The next question is it smart to invest in a data intelligence team at this time? We are trying to sustain our employees, but are struggling with the same because of the second wave of COVID. I'm very interested in investing in a data or a business analytics team, but not sure if that should be a priority at this stage.
It should be a priority. Rather, it should be a very big priority today. I mean, I'm not sure that you want to hire somebody from outside. I would say it is a priority for you to invest your time into this. It's not necessarily that you have to hire somebody to do that. But and especially for small businesses, you don't really need to hire. You need to prioritize. You need to prioritize. It should be one of the top agendas for you to really have that. And also put systems to really get the right logical data. Otherwise, you get opinions, you know, and that's not something which, again, go back to what I was trying to explain. You get expert viewpoints quite a bit. Everybody has a viewpoint on things, which is good because they have some understanding because they're in market, but it is backed by data. So unless and until I would mix these two things together, decisions should not be taken.
Sure. The next question I have is, what is the future of real estate data analytics? Who all are the buyers of such analytics?
A lot of them. I mean, real estate, though, obviously, it is a huge, huge work going on. And with all the major real estate advisory firms, have a lot of investment. Good ones are obviously the JLLs and CBREs and likes of them. They do some. I also personally, because I have a real estate investment company called Remax, but I actually go out and read them more because I feel that they've done some really good work in terms of their forecasts and you know their market behaviors. And so almost every month they would create a lot of these reports for the industry. And a lot of other companies are also there. And I think mature developers today are investing a lot on doing it, even to create their offering, what they want to do, because it's now becoming very, very difficult. Different products are available in the market. A particular site, would you choose it for doing value home, or you want to do a premium housing, you want to do luxury? And these are very important decisions. And it's not really about the what would be just required, because the project has to run for next 4 or 5 years. And you need to really see that the project would have continuous demand for next 4 or 5 years. And things would change in 3 to 4 years. So it's actually analytic of strong data is actually it's a very important need. And it's a large investment project. It would need a much in depth of understanding. And a lot of people have done mistakes. And if you really see, the lot of developers who've gone wrong is not because they didn't have ability to sell, or they were not aggressive or whatever. It was the wrong choice of project, and the timing was wrong, and they were not able to sustain it. Look at a group called JP in Noida, which invested so much in creating those kind of possibilities. They invested into creating even a formula track, which was 2,000 crore, in the predictability that it would create a lot of demand around it. And that didn't happen. So that money was not even recovered. So it's a wrong decision sometimes. If it were backed by understanding, is it able to create that kind of a demand? It would create an opportunity for a place where people would really buy homes because they want to be in a sports city like that. And I mean, he thought very Dubai-centric approach. Dubai has done this many times. And because it attracts tourists and people from all over the world, which Noida is not attracting. So it using a strategy of Dubai to Noida is wrong. Noida is an end consumer market, and he wants to be close to where he works and lives, not for living for leisure. Versus in Dubai, you can really have a second home or a third home in Dubai, and you would take a leisure decision than taking a decision. So a lot of things can go wrong with people when they don't really hear what the market is telling them.
Sure, sir. The next question is not specific to our topic of the day, but I would still like to take it up. The question is, my son is 17 years old and he wants to do BBA and wants to become an entrepreneur in the future. Can he attend any sessions held by you?
Sure. Please, anytime. And this is the best time for them to attend that. Rather, you should encourage them to be doing their entrepreneurial journey as young as possible. And that's what is very important. I feel that the young people from age of 14, 15 to about 20, they are the best time to really conceive their startup ideas. They're the best time to really nurture entrepreneurship because absolutely best time to do that. And that's what become even more younger. And I was actually in Oxford in for a visit, and they showed me a BMW has set up a lab there, which is innovation lab in there. And this was kids of 13, 14 were working on that because they said the next level of startup ideas, innovations would come from this age group. And BMW actually sponsored that piece for them for looking at the next level of creativity in mobility. And that was the whole project. And that's what is happening. If you really see the kind of ideas people are discovering these days are coming from absolutely, you know, fresh thinking and fresh possibilities and problem solving, which sometimes in a later age, like at my age, it becomes very orthodox thinking. You know, while we can do all these talks and share our good viewpoints and our numbers, but really speaking, in our businesses, sometimes at my age, I am a roadblock for a fresh thinking. The young people have much better thinking capability.
Another question on similar lines is, to get into a career in data analytics, is it really required to have a technical or IT knowledge and skills, according to you?
You have obviously IT knowledge. I would not use the word. I would say IT tools. Tools are very important because data is becoming bigger and bigger in any form. You cannot manage that, but there are many tools available. There are many tools available to churn your data, understand your data. You need to choose very carefully which stage of business you are in. And there are a lot of tools for small businesses which are available, which are very good tools for you to really understand and draw a little insight. But before you even start drawing and using the tool and things, what is your ask is very important. And that should be simple. You know, what you are really trying to ask is very important. And stay very focused on that. Rest is easy, you know. What you need to do that. And that's what, to me, is very important. So how do you really, what is your ask is more important.
And the last question I would like to take up is, how data intelligence works to sustain business excellence for long periods of time? That is pretty much the gist of the whole session, but anything you would like to add up to that?
Sorry, I missed your point. Question?
How data intelligence works to sustain business excellence for long periods of time?
Yeah, so this is what the whole session, as I said, is completely on that. I mean, how do you really, but essentially to make you future ready, that's something which I would say is the need of data analysis. If can tell you that what is going to be future lies for you and how you can be adaptable to that feature, nimble to that feature, and change it accordingly, and stay honest to what you are. Reliance has changed their strategy of energy because they feel the energy itself would change. It no more would be traditional fuel, which would be a play important role. The new energy would play a role. So the transition would be easy now because they've clearly understood the next 20 years is transformation. And they would go out and look at almost all possibilities of next energy cycles. It can be biofuels and it can be solar. It can be any other thing possibly which needs to be done. Electric is anyway a big future for going in different levels of energy. So all these energies you will see these companies would quickly adapt to. And that's what they are doing. Adani just made a big investment in acquiring Bharti's assets in renewable energy. And clearly the transformation, you can see how companies are thinking and they're moving towards that. So you also have to be really future ready. And today, good part is that you can really secure the data. Earlier days, to get the data was impossible. You know, how do you really get to understand what your customer is trying to tell you? Today is simple. While you have to cut a lot of noise also, because a lot of noise is not true. And that's where you need to be really connected with your customer to understand what they're telling you.
Sure, sir. So with this, I would just like to wrap up our Q&A session. Thank you so much, Gaurav sir, for once again answering all the questions very patiently. Anything you would like to say in the end?
No. Thank you very much. Thanks for joining another session of mine. It is your valuable time you take out. So I thank you for coming over. And keep sharing your thought process, anything you want from us to really bring in next time. While we have a calendar to bring in a different topic every time on business excellence. This is the second series I'm doing. I did one more series earlier, which is invest, scale, exit, and value your business. That's also on our Business X Facebook channel. So if you want to refer anytime, anything on that is all available. It's all on the internet. So thank you very much. Thanks for coming in. And if you are looking to scale your business or raising capital or looking for a exit planning, please reach out to Sonali, and her business looks after that part of the business. So if you any need you have, please reach out to her, and she and her team would be able to find right answers for you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. And thank you to all our attendees. We really hope we were able to add some value to your lives through this session. We'll see you next Saturday at 11 a.m. with another session in our BX Academy series. And if you have any questions, any concerns, or if you want the recording of any of our previous sessions or this session, please feel free to reach out to me, and I'll be very happy to help you. Thank you so much.